This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Grace, peace, and justice in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship this sixth Sunday after Pentecost. My name is Dawn Conte, and it is my joy to serve as pastor for this congregation, where our mission statement is to be and to make disciples of Jesus Christ, who know the Lord and who through love serve God and others. First Presbyterian Church is an open and inclusive church, and we are passionate about helping our neighbors in our immediate community and in the larger world. If you are an every Sunday attender, or if this is your very first time to be with us, thank you for worshiping with us today. You are warmly welcomed here. This week in the life of the church, today at 11:15, the Contemporary Faith Adult Sunday School class meets, and Grief Share meets at 4 p.m. Tomorrow on Monday, please feel free to join us for devotions with Pastor Dawn at 10 a.m. All are welcome. And on Tuesday, the Personnel and Administration Committee meets at 5 p.m. and Meditation for Christians meets at 7 p.m. On Sunday, next Sunday, you're invited to join the Faith Journey Adult Sunday School class that meets every Sunday at 9 a.m. All of these meetings are virtual meetings, and if you would like to join and need the Zoom account link, please contact Amy in the church office. And now, let us turn our hearts and minds to God in worship. Christ is alive. The Spirit is poured out. Lives are transformed. God is active in our world. God brings hope and healing. The Spirit of God invites us into community. We are called to see beyond ourselves and to join in loving care for all of those who are around us. We accept God's call and we rejoice in the gift of community. The earth is stressed by the heavy impact of human use. The whole of God's creation is groaning, crying in pain. We name the earth as part of our community. We extend our love to all of God's creation. Gather now to worship God, the creator and redeemer of the world. Gather now to be transformed by God's compassionate love. We praise with joy the world's creator, God of justice, love, and peace.
Oh, Please join me in reading together the prayer of confession. Holy and merciful God, in perfection you created the earth, fixed the course of the sun and seasons, and populated the earth with plants, fish, birds, and animals, and human beings, the crown of your creation. To live in an intricate, balanced web of life, you created us in your image and gave us responsibility to care for the world. We confess that we have not always been good stewards. Our lust for comfort and money has polluted the water. We choke the air with gases that not only poison both plants and animals, but also change the Earth's climate at great peril. We have cut too many trees to sell lumber or to build houses. We have drained too many fertile marshes and wetlands to create usable land. We have destroyed too many wildlife habitats in the name of progress. For what we have done and left undone, we are sorry. Enlarge within us the fellowship with all living things. We ask for your forgiveness and that you would create a right heart and mind within us, that we may consume according to our need instead of our want. Inspire us to actively heal your creation and therefore secure the home you have given us for generations to come. Please offer your silent confessions to the Lord at this time. Amen. The good news in Christ is that when we face ourselves and God with the awareness of our need, we are given grace to grow and courage to continue the journey. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, Will and Clara and Sam and Evan and Lucy and Heidi and Adeline and Noah and Ezekiel. I'm so glad you're here this morning. I have a very special story to tell you today. You can see here, I brought my very favorite flower, the sunflower. The reason it's my favorite is because it's sort of special. It does something very special. And I'm going to tell you a true story. Are you ready? I love true stories. Every summer, I plant sunflowers. I always have to plant a lot more than I really need because you know what happens? The birds eat the seeds. The squirrels dig up the seeds, and oh, gross, those slugs eat the plants. So last summer when I planted my sunflowers, I was left with one sunflower plant. But boy, he was huge. He grew so fast, and his stalk was nice and round, and he was going to be a mammoth sunflower. Boy, he grew, and he grew, and he grew. Now, boys and girls, I'm 5 feet tall, and I want to show you how tall my sunflower grew. Do you see this? Here I am, and here's my sunflower. He grew over 8 feet tall, and his head was huge, and he was going to be a beautiful sunflower. And I was so proud of him, because I had worked very hard keeping him from the slugs and the squirrels and the birds. He was growing. He was getting bigger and prettier every day. Well, one day when I was in the backyard, it was evening time. The sun was beginning to set, and I was looking at my sunflower, and I was so excited about it because I knew he would provide lots of sunflowers for the squirrels and the birds. All right, so I went in the house and had dinner, and all of a sudden while I was eating dinner, a storm, one of those quick pop-up storms came by. and the wind began to blow, and the rain came, and I worried about my sunflower. But after a while, a quick storm went on its way. And I went outside to check on my sunflower. Oh my goodness, I was so sad, my heart just broke. There was my beautiful 8-foot sunflower. His head was drooping. The wind had broken part of his stalk, and he couldn't raise his head. So I ran into the garage and got some duct tape. I don't know if you know what duct tape is. It's that big, fat, thick tape that you wrap around things to keep them strong. So I wrapped it around his neck. So I ran in the house in and got some material strips to give him a band-aid around his neck. So I put that around the duct tape and tied it tight. His head was still drooping a little bit more. So I ran and got the ladder. I did a lot of running that day. I ran and got the ladder, and I dragged the ladder over to this 8-foot tall flower. And I gently laid his head on the ladder to support it, because he was so heavy with seeds. I thought, oh, this isn't going to work. I don't think he's going to make it. But I had done all I could. But remember now, he was facing the setting sun. I want you to remember that. That's the direction he was looking, because that's where he gets his strength and power. So I left him. Went in the house, and the next morning I got up. I couldn't wait to go out and see what happened to my sunflower. I just knew it was going to be drooping. Oh my word. I ran out. I was so surprised. He wasn't turning toward the sunset any longer. He had turned his broken neck all the way around to the sun, because the sunflower knows where its strength comes from and its power. And he did that, boys and girls, for several days. He would go this way to the setting sun and back around to the rising sun. And by the time he was ready to drop all the seeds, he had a snake-like neck. It was like this. He had turned himself so many times. He had to get to his source of power. Now that sunflower reminds me of us. God is our source of power and our source of strength. When we're afraid, or sad, happy, and we're glad, and we want to say thank you, God, He is our strength. Just as that sun is the sunflower's strength, God is our strength. I want you to remember that. And sometimes as adults we forget that, but I want you to remember. Now, here he was with his crooked old neck. And the day had come, finally. God created him to do this. All the seeds fell down, and boy, the squirrels and the birds, they had a feast. Because that was God's purpose, was to feed the animals. This is another one of God's wonders. I want you to remember, when you see a sunflower, he seeks his source of strength with the sun. We, God's people, seek our source of strength through the God. Remember, we seek our strength through God. Now, if you remember, last time I was here, I had a little poem. Actually, it was a little prayer. You probably know it. Thank you for the world so sweet. Thank you for the food we eat. Thank you for the birds that sing. Thank you, God, for everything. Thank you for making the sunflower to remind us to seek our Creator, to seek God in times that are frightening, in times that are happy, in times that are sad. He is there for us. Remember, the next time you see a sunflower, it's a magical flower. I'm so glad you joined me today. Now, next month I'll be back with you again, but I won't be out here. It'll be somewhere else I think you're really going to enjoy. Take one last look at the sunflower. He was just this tall, boys and girls, over 8 feet tall. I will see you next month. Bye-bye.
The scripture this morning comes from Romans 8, verses 18 through 25. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is yet to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been in groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for the adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes of what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it in patience.
This morning's sermon is the sixth in a series entitled God's Resilient People, The series focuses on encouraging us in our discipleship to persevere in following Jesus Christ, especially during the tumultuous times in which we are living. The scripture this morning is Psalm number 8. I will be reading from the New Living Translation. Listen now for God's word to us. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. You have taught children and infants to tell of your strength, silencing your enemies and all who oppose you. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think of them, human beings that you should care for them? Yet you have made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority, the flocks and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish of the sea, and everything that swims the ocean currents. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I invite you to pray with me. Merciful and gracious Creator, we are grateful for your world on this summer morning. We are grateful for this church that calls us to worship together and to join you in caring for your world. In this time together, speak your word to us that we might believe and trust you with our lives and go from here to love and serve the world in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Today we celebrate God's creation and the vocation that God has given to each of us for the care of God's world and all that is in it. This beautiful poem by author James Weldon Johnson describes the wonder of creation better than anything I can think of.
The creation. And God stepped out on space, and he looked around and said, "I'm lonely. I'll make me a world." And far as the eye of God could see, darkness covered everything, blacker than 100 midnights down in a cypress swamp. Then God smiled, and the light broke, and the darkness rolled up on one side, and the light stood shining on the other. And God said, "That's good." Then God reached out and took the light in his hands, and God rolled the light around in his hands until he made the sun. And he set that sun ablazing in the heavens. And the light that was left from making the sun, God gathered it up in a shining ball and flung it against the darkness, spangling the night with the moon and stars. Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world. And God said, "That's good." Then God himself stepped down, and the sun was on his right hand, and the moon was on his left. The stars were clustered about his head, and the earth was under his feet. And God walked, and where he trod, his footsteps hollowed the valleys out and bulged the mountains up. Then he stopped and looked and saw that the earth was hot and barren. So God stepped over to the edge of the world, and he spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes, and the lightnings flashed. He clapped his hands, and the thunders rolled. And the waters above the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. Then the green grass sprouted, and the little red flowers blossomed. The pine tree pointed his finger to the sky, and the oak spread out his arms. The lakes cuddled down in the hollows of the ground, and the rivers ran down to the sea. And God smiled again, and the rainbow appeared and curled itself around his shoulder. Then God raised his arm and he waved his hand over the sea and over the land. And he said, "Bring forth, bring forth." and quicker than God could drop his hand, fishes and fowls and beasts and birds swam the rivers and the seas, roamed the forests and the woods, and split the air with their wings. And God said, "That's good." Then God walked around, and God looked around on all that he had made. He looked at his sun, and he looked at his moon, and he looked at his little stars. He looked on his world with all its living things. And God said, "I'm lonely still." Then God sat down on the side of a hill where he could think. By a deep, wide river he sat down. With his head in his hands, God thought and thought, till he thought, "I'll make me a man." Up from the bed of the river, God scooped the clay, and by the bank of the river he kneeled him down. And there the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it in the sky, who flung the stars to the most far corner of the night, who rounded the earth in the middle of his hand, this great God, like a mother bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust, toiling over a lump of clay, till he shaped it in his own image. Then into it he blew the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen. Amen.
Wow, just think about all the majestic sights we have just seen in that video and heard described through that wonderful poem. In the creation, God has provided us with a beautiful home. God's creation is full of beauty, diversity, and unending creativity. From the snow-capped mountains of the Himalayas to the deep crevices of the Grand Canyon, from the glaciers and the penguins to the Amazon rainforest, from the black beaches of Hawaii to the sand dunes of the Sahara, from the jellyfish to the humpback whales, from the koalas to the mighty grizzly bear, from the osprey to the parrot. And did you know that there are 15,000 species of butterflies? And while we are pondering the wonders of creation, of course, we remember that God made us the pinnacle of creation. God made human beings just a little lower than the angels and crowned us with glory and honor because we have been made in God's image. And just like we would give the car keys to our teenage daughter or sons, God has put each of us in the driver's seat when it comes to being good stewards of all that God has made. God's resilient people care for God's creation. But sadly, we haven't always lived up to our vocation. Our beautiful world that God created is groaning in labor pains and waiting for deliverance from deforestation, the flat toppings of mountains for coal consumption, and also the destruction of wetlands for housing projects. Our planet is in trouble. Entire species are endangered. Many of our lakes and our rivers and our streams are contaminated, and global warming is a reality. What can we do about melting polar ice caps or extreme weather or the beginning of migration of plant life and also of animal life to new habitats which may not be life-sustaining for them? Left unchecked, scientists have warned us that rising sea levels could flood our coastline, resulting in displacing one half of the world's population. Not only that, but rising acid levels in our oceans threaten corals and other marine life. If we remain on the present course, experts say that there will be worldwide crop failures and livestock failures. And not only that, there will be the spread of disease, by the mosquitoes and diseases like malaria and dengue fever and the Zika virus, which results in birth defects of unborn children. Although many do try their best to care for Mother Earth, others simply see the Earth and her treasures as a means to an end to line their pockets, to satiate their greed, and to make their lives easier without giving a care to how their actions may negatively affect the Earth. And when that happens, our future is jeopardized as well as the future of future generations. Here's the truth. God loves the world and everything in it, and we should too. Perhaps the most widely known scripture of all the Bible is John 3:16. God so loved the world that God gave God's only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The word from the Greek that has been translated as world is cosmos. In other words, God loves everything that God has created. Human beings, the world, and everything that is in it, and the far reaches of space. The task before us to care for God's creation, however, can be daunting and even immobilizing, but not for three teenagers who focus on making the world a better place. Perhaps you have heard of them, Greta Thunberg from Sweden, and two sisters, Melody and Isabel Wiesen from Bali. These Gen Xers are determined that they want to protect the Earth and her riches for their children and their grandchildren to come. As Isabel has been quoted as saying, "Us kids may only be 25% of the world's population, but we are 100% of the world's future." Greta began a movement called Climate Strike, which focused on pressuring the Swedish government to sign the Paris Agreement, which they did. And Melody and Isabel started a crusade to rid their beautiful island of Bali of plastic trash that continually washes up on her shores and lines the streets of Bali. After participating and organizing a hunger strike, they met with the governor of Bali, who signed an order banning all plastic bags, all plastic straws, and styrofoam from the island of Bali. These three girls have been featured in Time magazine. Last year, Greta was named as Time's Person of the Year. And Melody and Isabel made Time's list of the most influential teenagers in the world. God's Spirit is leading these three to care for the Earth in tangible ways and to make a difference for future generations, while also mobilizing thousands to follow their lead. God's resilient people honor God's creation and protect it for future generations. Yes, there is still much work to do, but there is so much hope. Because more people are staying at home during this pandemic, the most polluted places in the world, places like Los Angeles and cities in India, are experiencing blue skies for the very first time in years. The EPA, during this time of confinement and virus, is also continuing to undergo studies that to try to understand how human activity affects air quality. Hopefully, we will be able to use what they find out to shape public policy for the time when our roads start being traveled again more heavily and factories reopen. Did you know that scientists have found that because of the lower levels of pollution, there has been a decrease of 360 deaths per month in people who have asthma, who have lung disease, and heart disease? The state of California is leading the way in the nation in implementing tough clean air policies. They have made it a goal to reduce planet warming gases by 2030, and they have committed to having an entirely electric bus system by 2040. God's resilient people honor God's creation. And if we are to honor our vocation as stewards of God's earth, then every one of us must find specific ways to genuinely care for the earth. In his book Lyrics, Oscar Hammerstein tells of a photo that he saw that was taken from a helicopter at the very top of the Statue of Liberty. What impressed Hammerstein so much was the amount of detail that the sculptor created in creating Lady Liberty's hair and crown. This sculpture was created long before there were things like helicopters or airplanes. And even though that sculptor probably thought that no one else would ever be able to see the top of that statue, he made it with such care and took such painstaking effort to make it as excellent as he made Lady Liberty's face and hands and feet. That sculptor was committed to excellence. Hammerstein wrote, "When you are creating a work of art, or any kind of work for that matter, finish the job off perfectly. You never know when a helicopter or some other instrument not yet to be invented may come along and find you out." The artist of the Statue of Liberty was committed to excellence and to attending to the fine details of his work. That artist reminds me of our God, who has created a world and a universe with many treasures yet to be discovered, far more than we could ever ask, far more than we could ever imagine. Taking care of such a wonderful gift demands our best. In light of what God has so generously given to us in the wonders of creation, how can we do anything but our best in caring for God's world? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to pray with me. O Lord, our Lord, you have created the universe by your eternal word and have blessed humankind in making us stewards of the earth. We pray for your world that we may share and conserve its resources and live in reverence for the creation and in harmony with one another. Inspire us to be proactive, working to make the world better than we found it, so that it may be enjoyed for those who are to come behind us. During this time of pandemic, teach us what we need to learn so that we may more wisely manage your resources in the future. We pray for our country as we fight this virus. Help all of our leaders and government and each of us as individuals to make wise decisions that keep in mind the most vulnerable among us. We pray for the scientists who work to guide us and those who work to find a vaccine. We lift to you our first responders and their families, those who are out of work, those who are separated from loved ones, those who grieve, and for those who are hungry. Help us to be generous in sharing with those in need. We ask for your healing where healing is needed in mind, body, and spirit for those whose names are listed on the First Presbyterian Church prayer list and for those who care for them. Thank you for the life and witness of Ilda Hall Littell. We are grateful that pain and suffering has passed for Ilda and trust that she has now been received into your kingdom. We ask for your comfort and presence for her daughter Carolyn and for Carolyn's family as they grieve. We also pray for those who have recently lost loved ones, including David Conyers and Rhonda Hollifield, the Lyle family, the Keeney and Gulbis families, the Mossman family, and the Helk family. We pray for those known to us who are fighting COVID, including Tom Summers and Cameron Trimble. We lift to you Kay and Sean Trembley's brother-in-law, David, and his family as David recovers from surgery and will be undergoing chemo. We thank you for improved health that has come to Carol Abernathy, and we pray for her continued healing. We lift to you all who are receiving ongoing care, including Susie Robertson and Peter Pav. Bless the work of your church at First Presbyterian this week. Specifically, we ask your blessing on the Personnel and Administration Committee, as well as the Day School Advisory Committees as they meet. We ask your blessing on the licensing teams that are taking place, listening teams that are taking place in our church, that they might bring comfort, healing, and wholeness. Bless those who continue to give their best in creating meaningful worship services during this time of physical separation. Bless those in our congregation who continue to care for the body of Christ in this congregation through prayers, calls, notes, shopping, and providing transportation when needed. And now we join our voices together in the prayer that Jesus taught as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. What will we return to God for the bounty of the universe that God has shared with us? God's tithes and our gifts make it possible for us to serve those in need in St. Petersburg and beyond. May the offerings that we share restore and affirm the worth and dignity of our brothers and sisters in need who, like us, are made in the image of God. During this season, while we are physically apart, please remember that we are concerned about the ongoing ministries of the church and also about the well-being of our church employees' families. The financial viability of the church remains dependent on your generosity, so please continue to give generously, and thank you for the many ways that you support First Presbyterian Church, St. Petersburg. I invite you to pray with me. Lord, it is only because of your generosity that we have anything to give. At this time in our week, we pause and we remember that everything that we have is a gift from you. Use these offerings to reflect the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. As you leave worship this morning, remember that God has entrusted us with a holy vocation. We are to be the stewards of God's beautiful creation because Christ has no body on earth now, no hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the hands through which Christ touches the world. Yours are the eyes through which Christ looks with compassion onto the world. And yours are the feet through which Christ travels to do good. Christ has no body on earth now, no hands, no feet on earth but yours. So go and be Christ's body. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Alleluia. And all of God's people said, Amen.